what do they bring to our customers from an AI point of view. And I was able to identify at least four different levels. The first one is an obvious one, which is basically to eliminate recurring and low value added tasks done by employees. The second one, which is correlated, is basically to normalize and be more consistent in the accounting practices, because basically AI is using historical data and is basically proposing the same kind of value. Whereas when you use human people, they may have some creativity. Even in accounting, you may have creativity. So the fact that you standardize on an AI product will normalize things. Another angle where it helps is really the forecasting of the activity and tracking anomalies. So for the forecasting, what we've seen is that by being able to say next week you will have a big load or bigger load than this week, you, like many invoices, because it's the beginning of the month, because it's, I don't know, it's June or July and it's a heavy month for you, then you probably have to staff your people accordingly. So it helps also sizing your team to absorb the load. And the fourth point is the reduction of frictions we are seeing between suppliers and customers. Basically, AI is playing in the middle and is simplifying integration between systems. So by pushing a lot of AI, you will basically reduce the effort for the supplier or the customer to change their system. The AI will basically understand what the supplier is doing and will talk to the customer in his own way. So there are less change management to be made, because we can support the existing exchanges and make them more understandable for systems, but basically without forcing either the supplier or the customer to change the habit. This is super important, and we're seeing competitors that are coming with platforms selling to their customers, and those customers would force their supplier to use this platform, to use their user interface and things like that. We do not believe in that. We really believe that AI, and computer science today should do this job of adapting the communication between suppliers and customers, so that you have an easy integrated ecosystem. And for Esker, what AI is bringing to our solution is basically helping us to be ahead of competition. Very often, with prospects, they are asking us to demonstrate our solution and our recognition rate out of the box. So they give us like documents that we need to process and extract. And so this is a big way for us to win in those cases, showing super good percentage of recognition. So from an Esker software company point of view, this is clearly a competitive advantage. Most applicable, I would say, recurring tasks on semi-structured information. What I'm calling semi-structured information could be like orders or human readable orders or invoices or bill of ladings, I mean, any business document. They do have a structure, but it changed from one example to another. AI would play very well there. Whereas if the information is super well structured, the record, I mean, like the EDI space, which is exchange of information between two systems. It's normalized, it's standardized. In this case, you better go with a classical algorithm to read the information instead of going through AI. So it's when the information is there, but it's not super well structured, that AI can play a big role. And classical algorithm would fail. Of course, you would need a lot of examples to feed the learning system. And when I'm saying a lot of examples, I'm saying labeled data, meaning if I take the example of pictures, it's not because you have millions of pictures that you have a good data set. For each of them, you need to know that it's a dog, it's a cat, it's a flower. This is what we call the label data. And so if you don't have the label data, then you cannot train your AI. This is what we call supervised learning. And on the list side, of course, you have the opposite, which is okay, it's a recurring task, but not that recurring. So you don't have that many examples, and it's super hard to train an AI, because AI has a kind of weakness compared to our human brain, is that we can learn out of like 5 or 6 examples. It's very easy for us, whereas you need thousands or millions of examples for AI. Like AI is not that good, is on the customer or supplier interaction for non-trivial question and answers. And when there is an issue for something between two companies, you better have humans talking and negotiating instead of an AI answering things. I haven't identified three challenges at least. The first one, we talked about it a little bit. It's the volume and quality of the data set. Again, an AI needs a lot of data and a lot of quality data with nice label. So this is probably the number one criteria. Even before having talented people or anything, is having a good quality of data and a big volume. The second issue is more on the uncertainty of the results. It could take 6 to 12 months of trial and errors before figuring out if it's the right approach. Right now, this area is not well formalized. There are no recipe. As I said earlier, there are many new technologies or algorithms in the AI space that are publicized through research paper that you need to read, and then you apply and you test, you see the percentage of error, and you play with that. And sometimes, if you're lucky, you find the right approach, and then you think of industrializing your approach. And the third challenge is, for me, the mix between those people working on the AI algorithm and the developers. It's two different beasts. One is basically working on the long time frame, the AI people, the data scientist people, and the developers are more working on like 2 week sprints, and they know that they can deliver something within a specific time frame, even if they could be wrong for a few weeks. They can predict the future somehow. It's very, very not the case in the AI space. I mean, all our research took more than a year for each subject we tried to work on. I think it's difficult to assess if it's a real AI or not, because Every company could claim that a non-trivial algorithm could be described as AI. I mean, when you look in the books, in the literature, where a good definition of AI is super hard to find. So, I mean, each time it's complex, the company will claim it's AI. Another angle where it could be blurry is if you are consuming AI services. I mean, Google or Amazon and Microsoft are providing some AI services. If you consume their services, is it really AI? Basically, you are using their AI. They build the AI. You're just consuming it like an OEM. So basically, your system is doing AI. But from a software point of view, you are not really providing AI or developing or mastering AI. You depend on the quality of the service, in fact. And so I was thinking of some good questions to ask to detect if we're talking about people really mastering this space or not. And I mean, basic question like, are you doing deep learning? If the answer yes, then it's probably an AI company. Do you train the system yourself? Meaning you have data and you know how to train a system. What type of engine are you using? Engine are free. They are all open source. I mean, all the GAFA providing open source solutions. So this is not the issue. What the issue is really to master the engine and to train it. So answers like yes, we are using TensorFlow or PyTorch. TensorFlow is the Google engine and PyTorch, I think, is the Facebook one, are good answers. I mean, if the company is saying yes, they are using TensorFlow, it's probably an AI company, no doubt. I mean, you can go deeper and ask for the AI algorithms they are using. And if they come back with acronyms like RNN, CNN, LSTM, Transformers, SVM, or Random Forest, this is an AI company. It's important to note. I think it's important because it shows a barrier. I mean, for now, it's still complex to do real AI. Maybe it will simplify over the years, that maybe someone will come with a generic engine, but this is not the case right now. It's not really mature. And so I think assessing that those companies are doing real AI and are providing value to their customers is a barrier to competition. I think also that mastering your own AI enables you to enhance and adapt it to your customer needs, because it's like software. You have V1, V2, V3. I mean, you need to retrain your algorithm. So if you rely on someone else, it's harder to adapt, or I mean, you will adapt in a much slower space. And the third point is that when you understand AI within your company, it's easier to identify the areas where you can automate and where AI can play. It's not in the book. It's really playing with it and understanding how it works, that you can assess that, yes, in the chain of my process, this area I can automate. It's very hard to explain to anyone. I mean, there is no recipe again. So having people really understanding what we're talking about is tremendous help to identify where to invest in the AI space. What we're seeing from our users leveraging our AI components is that this is liberating them from tedious and recurring boring tasks. It is helping them to move to a more business-oriented job. with more interactions with customers or suppliers or employees or anything. To give an example, we just received yesterday a quote from an Australian customer saying that Esker has allowed me to sleep in. So they were like suffering like crazy, keying many, 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 many things, and had no time even to sleep. So it's giving them back time. And of course, this time is used to do more value added tasks. I'm not saying sleeping, but to do their, let's say, business job more than. So from a technical angle, you don't need to understand what's going on. We are trying to integrate AI. It's kind of hidden within our solution. We are just proposing values, fields, information to accelerate the processing of documents or business transactions. But there is no like AI components, and you need to talk to him. And it's really integrated in solution. And so we're trying to be not disruptive at all, which may sound strange, but it's seamless integration. This is what we target. So I wouldn't say it requires technological skills. Maybe it may require like to be patient somehow so that the system can learn. Sometimes the AI will do stupid mistakes at the beginning, which may upset users. But because the system is learning, those mistakes are disappearing over time. So there is like, okay, when we train the people, we say, don't worry at the beginning, it could be wrong, but it will learn and it will work perfectly over the weeks. So be patient. It may not work super well day one. That's so more understanding than anything else, what's going on underneath. This would be my summary. We are, regarding the workforce, we are not talking about artificial general intelligence yet. As I said, what it has forced us to do is to organize a data scientist group that is outside the development group, and they need to work together. But this group I'm not planning to have as many data scientists as I have developers. Probably AI within our product is 10% of the global effort. We're talking about, in an R&D of 150 people, we're talking about 10 to 15 people doing AI. But AI by itself is useless. You really need to integrate it in a global solution. Because, I mean, you cannot sell AI by itself. You really need something bigger. And software is still a super big piece, and usability, user experience is still a super big piece of the effort, honestly.